request for poverty infirmity tax abatement. I'll take a motion on that item.
Madam Chairman, I move that we grant a poverty infirmity tax abatement pursuant to Title 36 MRSA, Section 841(2), in the sum of $4,151.23.
Second.
Any discussion? All those in favor? 6-0. Now I'll invite you all to join us for the Pledge of Allegiance to the flag. I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the Republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all. I'll take a motion on accepting the minutes of our last meeting, number 16, 1990, held April 8th.
Second.
Any discussion? All in favor? 6-0. Tonight, I have the great honor of making the presentation of the Ralph T. Gould Award to Richard B. O'Donnell. Each year, the Cape Elizabeth Town Council recognizes one of its citizens with a Ralph T. Gould Award. This award, established in 1986, was named for Ralph T. Gould to recognize his community service and subsequently to recognize those who provide community service in the same spirit as Ralph Gould. Recipients such as Mr. Gould have been Bill Orcott, who has done much for the youth of our town, Judy Simons, a strong advocate of the arts and a former school board member, and Irv Chappell, who served as Director of Emergency Preparedness for over 25 years. Tonight, I'm proud to announce the recipient of this year's award. Richard O'Donnell, better known as Dick O'Donnell, has provided an immeasurable amount of time and caring on behalf of the senior citizens of Cape Elizabeth and South Portland. He helped to establish a monthly senior citizens luncheon that is sponsored as an ecumenical spirit by the churches in the area. Today, his enthusiasm is mostly responsible for seeing that the luncheon continues to occur. He has been very active in his own church, St. Bartholomew's, and according to his pastor, Father John Feeney, he participates in every activity available to lay parishioners. This year, Dick served as a member of the Main Street 90 Committee. In this capacity, he was the primary organizer of a very successful dance for our older citizens. He also established a call caring program that sought valiant volunteers to call shut-ins to provide them with a friendly hello. Dick O'Donnell exemplifies community service in Cape Elizabeth, and in choosing to assist senior citizens, he enables countless of residents to meet their neighbors and to truly make this more of a community. He is certainly a most worthy recipient of the Ralph T. Gould Award. So tonight, I am pleased to present Richard B. O'Donnell a plaque inscribed, Town of Cape Elizabeth, Ralph T. Gould Award, presented to Richard B. O'Donnell for outstanding citizenship in 1991. Dick's name will also be added to the Ralph Gould Award plaque, which permanently hangs at the rear of the town council chamber. Mr. O'Donnell.
Thank you very much for even considering me for this job. I'm going to tell you a story that I may not, won't take long.
I hope not.
Because I'm not known to be a long speaker. See, I see all these people I voted for. Now this is, so they know, how could they refuse but to vote for me? But in 1968, person on my left here who just said, don't let him speak too long. We were on the parish council of St. Bartholomew's. We didn't have a church. And Leroy Rand, you remember Leroy Rand? He coached the basketball team. He was assistant coach on the baseball, and very active. He was president of the council. He called me. And he said, Dick, Father McGarrigle, that was the pastor at that time in 1968, and he said, he would like you to go over to St. Albans Episcopal Church. They're having a meeting in the rectory there. And they would like you to represent St. Bartholomew. And I said, why me? He said, you're the oldest person on the parish council. Now, at that time, I was only 55, but I was a senior citizen. And I became a senior citizen, and last Tuesday, we finished our 23rd year of being together, senior citizens of St. Albans, St. Bartholomew's in Cape Elizabeth, Holy Cross, and First Congregational Church in South Portland. So, and I was, on this past Tuesday, I was re-elected president for the next 2 years, which means I'm going to be 80 when I retire. God willing that I'll live that long. Thank you very much for this honor. It's indeed a pleasure. I voted for you, too, and I voted for you. And I would have voted for Dave.
Feel that's why you got the placard.
That was decided long before the election. I just want to announce to everyone that this Sunday will be the last Sunday for the transfer station to be open for yard waste. And I also want to thank Councillor Rosemary Reed. This will be her last full meeting as a councillor, and she moves on to the school board. Thank you, Rosemary, for working hard with us this year.
Thank you.
And I also want to thank the voters of Cape Elizabeth and all the candidates who ran. We had a very exciting campaign, and I must say our faith in volunteerism and citizen concern was reaffirmed during this past election. I have a letter from Councillor Creelman, who's unable to be with us tonight, that he would like me to read to you all. He wants to publicly thank the citizens of Cape Elizabeth for their continued support and votes allowing him to continue in public service as a town councilor in Cape Elizabeth. I am not able to be present at this evening's meeting as a consequence of being inducted into the fellowship in the American Psychiatric Association, which is holding its annual meeting at this time in New Orleans, Louisiana. The actual convocation ceremony, when the medallion of fellowship is presented to me, actually begins at 7:30. Coinciding with the beginning of the town council meeting. The convocation is a once-in-a-lifetime opportunity such that Maggie has accompanied me on this trip. A final thanks to the voters who are returning me to office and apologies for not being able to make this evening's meeting. Sincerely yours, Wayne L. Creelman, LD. Any other items, members of the council? Councilor McLaughlin.
Are we on reports and correspondence?
Yes, that's what we're doing now.
Time. All right. Thank you. Just wanted to report that the Ordinance Committee of the Council will be meeting on May 29th. We again will be dealing with wetlands, specifically with timber harvesting and wetlands. We will be dealing with radio towers and the initial look at any potential revisions to a firearms ordinance. I did attend the April 17th meeting of the COG Executive Committee, at which we had an interesting and fruitful evaluation of the current and continuing director, executive director of that organization, John Bluebeer.
Any other reports or correspondence? We have citizens' discussion of items not on the agenda. There being none, we'll have another announcement to make. It's with great regrets that a very talented and well-liked
school teacher, Dr. Jean Tebow, died this past weekend, and we give our condolences to his family as well as to all his students and his fellow teachers. Now we present the War Veterans Recognition and Memorial Day Committee. Mr. John Betzold is here.
Thank you, Madam Chairman, members of the Town Council. I believe you have a copy of our revenue contributions and expenditures. Since this committee's been in effect, we've raised $5,410. We've expended approximately $1,300. We still have some outstanding bills that will be paid. We have thanked, again, all the contributors through cards and letters. We hope to have the landscaping all completed by the time of the Memorial Day ceremonies. The sod is in, the rock path is completed, and the stone obviously has been mounted. I don't know whether members of the Town Council have seen it, but the town garage and landscaping have done an outstanding job, and you ought to be commended. The monument, the only addition that we've made to it was to add the dates of 1775 to 1975, representing the Revolutionary War through Vietnam. The plaque that you saw received before you is represents the honor roll of the town of Cape Elizabeth veterans, and these are all the ones that are deceased or died in battle at a time of service. That will be at the ceremony on Memorial Day, and we hope to have it mounted permanently in the town council. We haven't made that decision yet. Where there is a booklet being printed up, I believe you have a cover of what it's the picture, which has the monument on it. That is in the process of being printed. It will list all the veterans, either deceased or who served during this time. Also acknowledge the people that helped us with this project. It's been a long project, but well worth it. I'd like to thank at this time the members of the town council and the manager and the clerks of the town office have been helping us with our raising the money and typing up the minutes. The plaque itself was made by the Industrial Arts Department. Local businessmen have helped us with the metal plaques that are on the face of the plaque. I'd also like to thank the Cape Courier for their advertising and free printing. The Memorial Day ceremony is coming along. We will be recognizing all veterans, and especially those the recent Persian Gulf conflict. And that's all I have. Our next meeting is May 20th, and we should have everything completed at that time. Hopefully that'll be one of our last meetings.
Thank you.
Thank you.
And in conjunction with the the ceremony, I believe Mr. Jim Murray's here to tell us about the festivities that day. You're looking well, Mr. Murray, considering
the latest ordeal. Thank you, fellas. I'm glad to be able to stand here tonight.
We are too.
I'm very pleased with the progress of the parade this year. We have, in addition to the paperwork that you have received, we have the United States Marine Corps Color Guard that has offered to come. I've also conned, I guess you want to call it conned, Councilor-elect Mr. Chaplin being the parade marshal this year. I had to do a little battering to get that, though. I wanted him to do in Flanders Field as long with the parade marshal, but he said that he'd be the parade marshal if I did in Flanders Field, so I said, you're on. The rest of it is pretty much self-explanatory. We've had some very good interest in people wanting to participate, and as you can well see through the agenda there, we've got a pretty good full agenda. On the program itself, to fill in a couple of slots, we have the National Anthem, the invocation, the Gettysburg Address, the dedication of the memorial, laying of the wreath in Flanders Field, the firing detail. I'm going to provide myself with some pyrotechnics from the Holman Field, so hopefully we'll have something left from the high school windows in time to get done. But we are unable to get the firing detail this year due to patriotic years, so hopefully we can pull it off. And we have taps, the benediction, and the dismissal of companies, and we are also going to have an open house at Engine 2's fire station this year.
Very good.
Any questions?
What time does the parade start, Jimmy?
9 o'clock at Fowler and 77. Those participating, I like them there between 8:30 and quarter 9. And if you'll notice on the auto of the parade, item number 6 is the town manager and town council, so I'd like to see as many as I can. Thank you.
Town manager, too. Very good.
As long as you have flags for us, Mr. Murray.
I have no flag.
Deal.
Well, on behalf of the town council, the town manager, and the citizens of Cape Elizabeth, I want to thank the War Veterans Memorial Committee for all their hard work, dedication, and research, and the Memorial Day Committee as well. Thank you. Any other reports and correspondence? If not, we'll move on to our public hearing of the Dead End Road Standards, item number 177. And I'll pass it over to John McLaughlin, Chairman of the Ordinance Committee.
Thank you, Madam Chairman.
Excuse me.
I believe this is an ordinance that we started work on close to a year ago, and hopefully are bringing it to some kind of conclusion this evening. We've had very good input from our town staff, including the town planner, the fire department, the police department, good input from citizens, good input from developers, and from the planning board. We have come to this point by creating a definition for emergency access lane, which I think I'd better read this evening, a public or private paved road with a minimum width of 18 feet, which is not open to through vehicular traffic. This type of road may provide secondary emergency access to an area served by a dead-end road. We are now proposing that dead-end streets shall not be longer than 2,000 feet in length and shall not serve more than 20 dwelling units. Notwithstanding another section, section 16.3.5, the maximum length, the maximum number of dwelling units, and the mandatory requirements of dead-end streets shall not be waived by the planning board. Any dead-end street in excess of 1,000 feet in length shall meet mandatory requirements for the entire length of the dead-end street. Mandatory requirements shall include, 1, the placement of all utilities underground, 2, the dedication to the town of a 50-foot wide right-of-way, and 3, a minimum paved width of 24 feet. Sub 3, the planning board may require improvements such as 1, the placement of sidewalks to town specifications, 2, limited clearing of the right-of-way with the advice of the tree warden on the stability of adjacent tree growth, 3, the provision of an emergency access lane with a minimum width of 18 feet, and 4, a minimum esplanade width of 6 feet for divided entrances. Sub 4, a dead-end street shall be measured between the points where only one means of access exists. Divided entrances shall be allowed only if they provide direct access to arterial streets as classified by the town. What we are trying to do with the proposed ordinance amendments are to mitigate the added risk potentially created in a lengthier dead-end street, and the risk that you incur if that dead-end street is blocked, emergency access to that dead-end street is blocked. That's why there are some mandatory requirements regarding the underground utilities and the width of the right-of-way especially. We're looking at longer dead-end streets than the current ordinance deals with, basically to accommodate the town's topography and the soil conditions that developers will run into in some of the lots, as well as the wetlands. A lot of this is done in an hoped-for effort to mitigate disturbance of some of the natural resources.
Thank you. Is there anyone from the public who wishes to make a comment? If you please come forward and give us your name and address.
My name is Bob Taylor, and I am a partner in Stonegate Associates, that is a land developer here in Cape Elizabeth. And while this proposed ordinance is designed to generally respond to the topographic and natural resource issues here in town, I just wanted to say that for the parcels of land that we have under consideration for subdivision improvements, this ordinance is appropriate for our proposed development scheme.
Thank you. Is there anyone else? If not, I'll close the public part of the hearing and the council will have its discussion. I have a question either of Mr. McGovern or Council McLaughlin. Has the town attorney reviewed this change?
Yes, it was sent to him with his packet, which he routinely reviews prior to meetings, and he lets us know of any problems that he sees.
Thank you. Comments from anyone? If not, I'll take a motion on this item.
Madam Chairman, I move that we approve the proposed revisions to the subdivision ordinance, section 16.1.4 definitions, and section 16.3.2 sub A, sub 9, dead end streets.
Is there a second? Discussion? All in favor? 6-0. And we have an addendum item 177A, to consider a parking fee for family fun day and take any necessary action. Mr. McGovern, would you give us some background, please?
Yes, I'd be happy to. As part of this year's budget process, the family fun day account for June of 1992 was cut by some $5,000, from $13,000 to $8,000. At that point, it was suggested that the family fun day committee may want to look at parking revenue as a possible option. Subsequently, the Family Fun Day Committee has met and voted to recommend to the town council that the parking fee should begin this year rather than next year as a way of building up funds for Family Fun Day. Specifically, they do recommend a $2 per vehicle fee, and that it should only have to be paid once. And upon anyone first entering the fort on Family Fun Day, they would be given a card to place in their windshield that would indicate as they come in subsequent times that they had in fact already paid the fee. It is expected that this particular fee would raise a couple of thousand, $3,000 to $4,000 for family funding.
Comments? Councilor Jordan.
Oh, you didn't ask public comments? No, I'm in agreement with it, and I'll make a motion that we charge a fee for Family Fun Day at a rate of $2 per vehicle, a one-time charge.
I'll second that. Discussion. Janet.
Does this have to go before the Fort Williams Committee?
No, this is in keeping with the existing policy for parking for special events for Fort Williams.
I'm not comfortable with charging $2 per vehicle. I'm glad it was only for the only being charged once, because I usually go up more than once during the day and I'm starting to add up $2 a number of times. I don't know. I'm not comfortable with that. I think it may cut down participation. I would consider $1, but $2 I really have a problem with. It's a town-sponsored event. It's a moneymaker, I know, for a lot of organizations. I would hate to see those organizations not make the money they're anticipating because people were reluctant to drive there. I would hate to see a lot more people, a lot more foot traffic, or bicycle traffic on Shore Road that day because of all the hazards of Shore Road.
Other comments? Councilor Reed.
Madam Chairman, in terms of our vote tonight, are we just voting on allowing the fee to be charged, or are we being asked to determine if the fee is acceptable?
We're being asked to approve the fee starting this year. Actually, we're voting a vote, but primarily whether or not the fee can start this year. Councilor Amaral?
I would agree somewhat with Councilor McLaughlin's hesitation to go forward with charging, particularly residents, for parking. In normal times, I would agree with you, but these are not normal times. And I think Family Fun Day is a very important community event. Unfortunately, we were not able to allocate the needed funds this year to carry on that day in the same form as it has been in past years. So I think that we have to look at other ways of raising revenue other than just the tax base. And although this would include charging a fee for Cape residents, it would also raise revenue from all of the people outside of Cape Elizabeth who do come and enjoy Family Fun Day, and particularly who come to enjoy the fireworks, as I still think we have the best fireworks celebration of anybody in southern Maine, maybe in the whole state. So given the fact that we are in real tough financial times, I think we need to do things like this. And so I'm prepared to support this $2 fee this year.
Councilor Pearson.
I was just going to come up with a creative alternative, possibly saying, like some of the car washes do by nonprofit organizations, say parking is free, however, donations are gratefully accepted, minimum donation $2.
Councilor
Jordan. I was going to say, I think that might actually work out beneficially, because some people, especially from out of town, might say, geez, what the heck, you know, for a full day of activities and everything for the whole family, here's five. Someone, you know, might be reluctant, town residents, say, I pay for this anyways, so be it. You know, it's just an alternative. Just throw it out.
Councilor Jordan.
I'm in agreement with Councilor Amaral, and I think the way the times are, this is time to start. And I just hope the committee has looked into how they're going to collect this fee and where they're going to collect it. And come evening when they go in there for the fireworks, I hope they got a handle on it so we don't have the traffic in Shore Road.
Great. Any further comments? All those in favor? Opposed. It's a 5-1. Item number 178, to consider a report from the Planning Board regarding daycare center standards and take any necessary action. Mr. McGovern, would you review this for us?
Yes. Some time ago, the Zoning Board recommended to the Town Council that the provisions relating to regulation of daycare centers be revised. Subsequently, they did make a specific proposal. It did come to the council, and the council referred it to the planning board. The planning board held a public hearing and is recommending back to the council a specific proposal. Basically, right now, day nurseries are defined in the zoning ordinance or provided for, and any day nursery, virtually, if it's anyone brings anyone up but other than their own kids, is under regulation. This new provision provides that a daycare nursery, it provides two separate standards. One is for a daycare home. That is a facility which provides a regular program of care and protection for seven or more children under the age of 16 or any number of children and other than the operator's residence for any part of the day. A second definition to be established would be day nursery, which would be a facility which provides a regular program of care and protection in the operator's residence for up to six children under the age of 16 for any part of the day. In the Residence A zone, permitted uses, daycare, home, and daycare nursery would continue to be permitted with planning board approval. However, a day nursery would not be subject to conditional use review by the zoning board or site plan review by the planning board. In other words, one with less than seven children. A day nursery, however, would require a use permit from the code enforcement officer. If the code enforcement officer receives an application for a use permit, he would send a notice to all abutters within 500 feet of where it's proposed. If no objections were raised within 30 days, the code enforcement officer would then issue the permit, provided four criteria are met. One is it shall not operate before 7 in the morning or after 7 at night. Two, a fenced outdoor play area would have to be provided with 75 square feet of space per child. Three, no outside play, shall be allowed before 9 a.m. on Saturdays, Sundays, and holidays. Four, adequate lighting should be provided at the vehicle drop-off and pickup area. Use permit appeals by residents and applicants shall be directed to the zoning board. Basically, what this is trying to do is to provide less regulation and not being forced to go to the boards for day nurseries of up to six children. And the planning board would recommend that the council receive this and refer it to its ordinance committee.
Mr. McGovern, anywhere do we make a statement requiring the state licensing? They'll still have to get the state permits as well, is that correct?
If they're over the state limit, they would need to get the state permit. The six is tied into the state requirements, and that's how that number was chosen.
So they would need to get
right. If they need, license. If they would need a state license, they would also need to undergo the local review by the both boards.
Okay, in the fire codes, the code enforcement officer would make sure that the facility is properly set up for fire codes.
That's correct.
Any other questions? That will take a motion. Councilor Amaral?
Madam Chair, I would move that this item be sent to the Ordinance Committee of the Town Council.
Is there a second?
Second.
Discussion?
I'd like to make just one comment. I'm happy to see this kind of streamlining so that the Planning Board does not get overburdened with items that can be handled in this manner. So I think this is one of the benefits from having a town planner, being able to set aside these items that don't have to take up the time of the Planning Board unnecessarily.
Councilor McLaughlin.
I'll follow up by commending the Planning Board for working on this as quickly as they did. The Ordinance Committee has had a preliminary look at this, and we sent it to the Planning Board at the end of January. So I would say they probably share your sentiment and want to have this moved along at our level also.
Any other comments? Not all in favor? Okay, that is 860. Item number 179, to consider a report from the Ordinance Committee regarding a proposed amendment to the sign ordinance and take any necessary action. I'll refer to Councilor McLaughlin, Chairman of the Ordinance Committee.
Thank you, Madam Chairman. At the Council's March 13th meeting, we adopted a new sign ordinance for the town. At that meeting, the Ordinance Committee was directed to consider a proposed amendment to the sign ordinance. That amendment would have increased from 250 to 300 square feet the maximum sign area allowed at a gas station. That's what prompted what Council has before it this evening. We did, in fact, review that proposed amendment. We have a three-member ordinance committee. There was a 2-1 consensus not to bring that amendment back to the Council. We did, however, realize that we could deal with the size of signs a little more thoroughly than we had already presented in the sign ordinance. That realization prompted what is before the Council this evening. This amendment would be on the page of the ordinance that was the chart page, more or less, that talked about the different sizes of signs, different types of signs in the business zones. And what we would propose is that any sign is governed by that chart and the information on that chart, unless it is specifically dealt with otherwise in another part of the ordinance. What the proposed amendment reads is that unless specifically designated, all sign types in the town shall be limited to the size restrictions in section 2113 sub A, which is the chart. Proposed signs shall be assigned the most applicable sign type category by the code enforcement officer, just to clarify that in the ordinance. This happens in ordinance work. The more you look at it, the more things you see that you wish you had put in. We had this quick opportunity and decided to take advantage of it. And at this point, if the council is willing, we would propose that it be considered to set to public hearing at our next meeting in June.
Has this been reviewed by our town attorney yet? It just seemed a little confusing in reading the proposed amendment by itself.
Not fully. He generally, in order to save the town legal expense, does not review the final drafts of ordinances until they're ready to go to public hearing.
Comments from anybody? Any questions? Councilor Jordan.
Seeing that I was in the minority on the amendment as far as the square footage of signs allowed at a gas station, I had a member at a previous council meeting that we allow so many square feet other than what is required by state, federal, and local ordinances. And I don't feel that we need to set up an ordinance where someone within the town has got to go measure the number of signs that is required by the state, federal, and local ordinances, such as the number of gallons you receive, the price of the gallon, all those that's on the meter, I think is unnecessary. So I come up with an idea, all those signs would be exempt, and we would allow so many more other signs allowed, and I come up with 250 plus, other than what is regulated by the federal, state, local ordinances. And I was willing to go back to 200, but the majority ruled, but I told them I was going to have my day in court at the council meeting. Thank you.
Anyone else? Council McLaughlin, would you explain how this might work for the average citizen who might pick this up and read it?
Fortunately for the average citizen, this would be attached to the rest of the sign ordinance, which would make life a lot easier.
Yes, even sitting here with a sign ordinance here in front of me, just...
Okay, if... this chart page. What this would mean is that a freestanding permanent pole sign would have to meet the size restrictions in section 2123 of the ordinance. In this case, it says a maximum sign area of 40 feet for that kind of sign. So even at a shopping center, there may be other areas designated within the ordinance. I believe that there isn't a shopping center. But anywhere else in town where it's not designated, a permanent pole sign could be as large as 40 square feet on its combined two faces. A residential sign still would be governed by the other parts of the ordinance. But unless it is specifically outlined in another part of the ordinance and given a specific size criteria, then the size criteria stated in this section would prevail.
Good. Thank you. Any other comments? If not, shall we set this for public hearing next month?
So moved.
Second.
At 7:30. All in favor? Item number 180, to consider authorizing the borrowing of tax anticipation notes and take any necessary action. Mr. McGovern?
You have a draft motion before you which authorizes the borrowing of $1 million in tax anticipation notes for the next fiscal year. What tax anticipation notes do is assist us with cash flow during the fiscal year. It is required that it be paid back before the end of the fiscal year. The town has regularly borrowed tax anticipation notes every year. I believe that the amount proposed for next year is probably one of the lowest amounts that has been proposed in many a year. At one point, the town was borrowing $2 million for quite a few years. This current year is $1.5 million. Next year, it's $1 million. I would like to point out, and actually this is more of a plug than pointing out, that this is not to be confused with the borrowing that the town is doing for more permanent improvements. It's there is a note that's being that's out, a 15-year note, that is available through Fleet North Star Securities. And if any resident wishes to invest in those bonds, they should directly contact that particular firm, because they will be sold in the next few weeks. And hopefully for the investors, it'll be a high rate, and hopefully for the town, it'll be a low rate. But no matter what, it'll be a fair rate. The actual rates will be set on May 20th. And that's my plug for the permanent notes, and it is, I think, a good opportunity for investment for our local residents. If you have any questions on the tax anticipation note, I'd be happy to answer.
You're going to confuse everyone. Councilor McLaughlin.
I have a question for the manager. Why are we now borrowing a lower amount than we have in the past?
Two reasons. One is because our cash flow is better than it once was, and we can't justify borrowing too much more than this. Second, when interest rates were higher, there was a significant opportunity to arbitrage funds. That is, to borrow at a lower rate and to invest in a higher rate. For the first time ever, we are currently at the position for what we borrowed at last July, we are currently have invested at a lower rate than we borrowed it at. It is actually for the first time costing us money. The investments that the town put out today, we got a rate of 5.75% for 45 days. A year ago at this time, we were regularly earning about 8%. So, you know, and in fact, this, as you'll note, is worded so that it doesn't give an exact date of when it would be borrowed. And it is likely that we will probably borrow this later than usual, because it's really not in the town's best interest to do it right at this point. And it may not be in July either. No matter what, we wouldn't borrow until July.
Thank you.
Questions from anyone else? If not, I'll take a motion on this item.
Madam Chairman.
Councilor McLaughlin.
I move that we authorize the town manager. Is that the correct form?
Yes.
Treasurer.
In his capacity as town treasurer, to borrow with the tax anticipation notes as presented to us this evening.
Second. Discussion? All in favor? 6-0. Item number 181, to consider a proposed lease of basement space at the town hall to the Cape Courier and take any necessary action. Mr. McGovern?
Councilor Reed.
Councilor Reed.
Madam Chairman, I would like to ask the town council if they feel that since I reported for the Cape Courier up until 2 months ago that I have a bonus and should we?
No.
Step down. Thank you.
Okay.
I see no problem.
There's no financial.
No.
I think there is no problem.
To the contrary.
Thank you.
Mr. McGovern.
Okay. The Cape Courier, which is the local volunteer independent community newspaper, has been utilizing space subleased from the Kennebec Girl Scout Council in the basement of the Kennebec Girl Scout Council building at Fort Williams. A little while ago, it became known to us that several years ago, the Girl Scouts had discontinued a second exit from the basement. Consequently, there's only one basement. We brought only one exit. We brought that to the concern of the Cape Courier. Concurrently, it was also known that the Girl Scouts were probably moving elsewhere, so the Cape Courier was in need of space. They did approach me to see if the municipality might have space available. With the Cape Courier, we looked at a number of spaces, and their preferred location was a room in the basement of the town hall, which is situated directly below the council podium. That was not a factor in the decision that it was below the council podium. But nonetheless, that's where the particular room is. The lease is drafted would be for a one-year term. The rent would be for $50 per month. The Cape Courier would be required to provide its own telephone. We would give them keys. We would allow them to place a sign in the interior of the town hall, but not in the on the exterior, in order to help maintain the knowledge that it is independent. That's a primary outline. Ellen Van Fleet, one of the founders of the Cape Courier, is here, should you have any questions.
Any questions of members of the council? Any comments? Council McLaughlin.
I have a number of questions. Is the Courier paying rent for the where it is right now at the Girl Scout building, or where it was at the Girl Scout building?
Yes, to my knowledge, they are. It's my understanding.
And was that rent paid to the town? And if so,
no, it was a sublease from the Kennebec Girl Scout Council.
Okay. I've got some questions that are probably better answered by Ellen if she'd come to the podium.
Yes, over to the podium, please.
They're easy.
Good evening.
Guaranteed. What, I know that there's a provision in here for keys to, a number of keys to go to the Courier staff if this is approved, so that they can be in here hours when Town Hall is not generally open, and certainly understanding the nature of your operation, I think that's appropriate. Can you give us a feel for the hours, general hours of operation you would expect people to be using the room?
The way we're currently operating, some people come in on maybe Thursday and Friday for 2 and 3 hours at a time to start building ads. Then the following Sunday, a worker comes in and is literally printing first copies from which we do proofing. And then on Monday and Tuesday, we're in pretty much the better part of the day. And if things go badly, we're in Monday night. So it's about that many days for each issue. There are times in between when some of us are running in for miscellaneous things, but those are briefer visits.
And one of my concerns, it was more a concern, I think, when you were at the fort, where it's people being there late at night with nobody else around.
Yeah, that has not been real pleasant with the gate and all, because we're there. We try and get out by 9 just because of the nature of the place. Mm-hmm. But we are getting better at not having to work Monday nights. We are trying to avoid that.
That's good in a lot of ways. And I think here, even if you were here at night, there's no traffic on the road, so if there were a problem, you could easily get help. So that leads me to believe there'd be 2 or 3 cars at a time in this parking lot because of this operation.
Yes, at most, probably, we have 4 in at a time. Maybe once in a while, we're lucky and have 5.
They would like 5.
We'd love it if you could put up with the cars.
Okay, I think with something we're looking at later this evening, we're going to see some potential increased parking here. One thing I'm wondering about is if there needs to be some kind of clause saying that, I mean, if the electricity goes out, do you lose things on your disk?
Oh, we can. We hopefully save often enough, we won't.
Okay, I'm wondering if there needs to be anything, that there be no claim against the town for utility failure. That's
we have no problems with Girl Scouts when it goes out, so I can't imagine.
I just wanted to bring that up. I'd rather bring it up now than
it's occurred.
Have you lose 2 or 3 pages on your disk and such.
No, that's not anybody's problem but ours.
Thank you.
Mr. Jordan.
My real concerns is passing the keys out. Now, do you have any rules and regulations, who has a key and how often they pass it along?
Currently we have 3 keys, and frankly that would be sufficient. And they aren't, can I say they aren't passed around? On occasion a volunteer does use my key to get in, and thus I know who is coming and going. And we can keep that system, that certainly is sufficient. If we had the 4th key, there's one other person who could have it, who is coming in more and more regularly, becoming much more involved. But we can live without that.
One question to the manager. if they're going to be working odd hours, that you might say Sundays and what have you, and there usually isn't too much goes on around here, Is the police department going to know their schedule?
They won't know their, you know, I think after a while they'll get comfortable knowing what the regular schedule is. The actual experience of the weekend here is that Lillian Bates is in and out all the time. Other cable folk are. There's seldom a time when I come in during the weekend that I don't run into someone. So it is fairly regular. Beyond that, this will work much as many of the other groups work, in that if anyone does need to get in and doesn't have a key, they would go to the police dispatcher, and the Cape Courier would provide a list of people who were eligible to get a key, some of the regular volunteers, and if the name was on the list, the police would release the key and the person would return it when they were done. We do that for a number of groups.
Well, I understand that you do that for other groups, and I was just wondering why you decided to issue keys out and not have them go over to the station and get signed out a key. I just get concerned of too many keys passed around the neighborhood.
We do issue keys for those who regularly, continually utilize the building. In this case, we were looking at the publisher. Is that your title? The publisher, the editor, Tom Summers, who is the chief.
He's the production assistant, and Sylvia does productions. Those would be the four, but if we wanted to keep it to three, we certainly can do that.
Okay, all set.
Any other comments? No, I'm sure Michael has thought this all out very carefully, and we'll follow through. I'll take a motion on this item, please. Councilor Reed.
Madam Chairman, I move approval of the draft lease to the Cape Courier.
Second. Further discussion? All in favor? Yes, 6-0. Thank you very much. Thank you, Ellen. You'll be a good neighbor. Item number 182, to consider proposed articles of incorporation and bylaws for the museum at Portland Headlight and take any necessary action. Mr. McGovern?
Yes, in order to receive contributions for the museum at Portland Headlight from a number of corporations, it is necessary for us to be incorporated as a 501c3 under the federal IRS codes. Basically, that means that the museum is being established for nonprofit purposes. The particular articles of incorporation provide that the funds would go toward the maintenance of the museum. It provides that there would be a board of directors, that the board of directors would be the town council, that the president of the corporation, the nonprofit corporation, would be the chairman of the Cape Elizabeth Town Council, that each and every June, at the same time the council was doing its organization, you would reorganize the corporation of the museum. All of the meetings of the museum corporation would be public, just as the council meetings are. The draft here did have a provision that telephone meetings would be allowed. It's proposed to delete that. While you could do it as the corporation for Portland Head, you couldn't do it as the town council, and it just, you know, it's unnecessary to have telephone meetings. You could have an executive committee if you chose. You can set up other committees if you chose. The other offices other than the president would be a secretary and a treasurer. The treasurer could be a person such as the town treasurer who would not be a director. You could be compensated, although that's a standard bit in bylaws, and I've never heard of any intent that there would be any compensation. And those are essentially the highlights of the draft articles of incorporation as well as the bylaws. These were drafted by legal counsel, a woman by the name of Elizabeth or Betsy McCandless, who is well experienced in establishing nonprofit corporations, doing a dozen or so of them a year. Our town attorney's office does not do this type of work, or could do it, but they would spend so much time on research that it was felt that it'd be a lot more affordable to go to someone with experience. This person was recommended.
Comments from councilors?
Councilor McLaughlin.
I had a question in one section of the bylaws. It's on page 5, which comes under Article 7, discussing meetings of the Board of Directors. It's section 4 on page 5, where it talks about a quorum and vote required. At any meeting of the directors, the majority of the directors then in office shall constitute a quorum for the transaction of business. And it's the next sentence that I was having some problems with. So the directors present at a duly convened meeting in which a quorum was once present may continue to do business and take action at that meeting, notwithstanding the withdrawal of enough directors to leave less than a quorum.
I believe this provision is a fairly standard one, and it's to avoid the problem you have in a number of organizations, several of which I was involved in earlier, whereby people were upset about something and they weren't getting their way, they left the meeting so that there would no longer be a quorum. I can remember that happening a few times, not in Cape Elizabeth, but elsewhere, on a very contentious issue.
I can see that happening. I can also see those people getting up and leaving and one person being left to make a decision.
I would assume that the Cape Elizabeth Town Council, in its capacity as directors, would be civil and professional and
He's not a counselor, you can
Councilor Amaro.
I think that this is standard procedure in most organizations and groups. If you have a quorum when you begin, people have to leave for whatever reason. You don't have to put off a vote. This is certainly not unusual practice.
I get it. I see it opening up a couple of potentials that I didn't like.
Well, being elected officials who are also on there and having publicized open meeting, I think you won't have one person sitting there making decisions. Councilor Jordan.
I just want to say that as this is written up, and I see that Councilor Reed's name is here, so if we add a new councilor, do you just automatically change the name, or do we got to go through the procedure again?
No, I gave
would she continue to serve on this board?
No, she would end her service upon, or any councilor would end their service on the board when they finish their service on the council. One reason the annual meeting is set up in June, so that automatically, if there are any new councilors, they can be considered for office in the corporation, and at the organizational meeting, they would become a director at the same time they became a member of the council.
So this isn't going to be available for the fundraisers until our meeting in June, is that correct?
No, because you're adopting it tonight, so it's in effect tonight, and then you will have the annual meeting next month.
The first annual meeting. Any other questions? If not, I'll take a motion on this item.
I move the adopt.
Second. Any discussion? All those in favor, 6-0. Item number 183, to consider approving a quick claim deed for U39-1-53A at 71 Hunts Point Road and take any necessary action. I'll ask our clerk, Mrs. Pizzo, to give us the background, please.
Thank you. The council has before it tonight a request to sign a quit claim deed or to authorize the town manager to sign one. This quit claim is to simply correct an assessment error in order to clear the title for this property, which I believe is going to be sold in the near future. The error in assessment was picked up by the title company, and I believe you have a copy of that memo to the assessor. At this time, this would be in order to have the town manager sign this.
Comments?
I'll move that we authorize the town manager to sign the quitclaim deed.
Second. Any discussion? All in favor? 6-0. Item number 184, to consider a proposed site plan for the town hall in 1226 Shore Road lots and take any necessary action. I believe Mr. Tom Emery is here to make a presentation to the council, and Mr. McGovern as well.
Yes, as the council is aware, you authorized almost a year ago now, or maybe not quite that, the purchase of property at 1226 Shore Road. Subsequently, the council, through the Municipal Facilities Committee, led by now Councilor-Elector of Chapel, provided recommendations for the use of the building. Essentially, they recommended that it be established as a community, as a center for community activities involving meetings, senior citizen programs, and a multiple assortment of other activities. Subsequent to the report of the Municipal Facilities Committee and its approval by the town council, the town utilized a competitive selection process to secure the services of professional engineering services. One of the identified needs was to provide additional parking, not only for this property, but also for the town hall. Thomas Emery of Terry and Architects has developed a site plan and is here to present it tonight. The process would be for you to provide any comments that you'd like tonight on the site plan. It's good, it's no good, it needs this change. We will then take those comments, and provided they aren't too substantial, we will move forward with an application to the zoning board for conditional use and to the planning board for site plan approval. And what I would hope tonight is that you would authorize those applications based on the plan being submitted through the good work of Mr. Emery, with any comments that you might have. So, Thomas Emery.
Thank you, Mike. I've seen this done a few times before, so I ought to have this down by now. You should all have a plan in front of you identified as a revised drawing L1. And if I could, I would just quickly like to go over some of the highlights of the plan. First, thank you, Madam Chairman and fellow citizens and councilors, for the opportunity to present this plan and see Irving Chapel here, the chairman of the Municipal Facilities Committee, locally known as Landslide these days, I guess. I'd like to thank him and the rest of the Municipal Facilities Committee for the work that they put together in getting us to where we are at this time. The purposes that we're trying to achieve here is to provide additional parking for Town Hall, to improve the looks of the parking lot behind Town Hall, to improve the circulation, particularly, I guess, egress from Town Hall after busy meetings, and to improve parking delineation. That is, when you enter Town Hall area, that it's clear where one is to park and how the circulation is to move. For the benefit of the viewers at home, if I could just orient the board. At the top of the board is Shore Road. Down the left-hand side of the board is Route 77. The large yellow square here is Town Hall, the shed behind Town Hall, and this is the Old Jones property, 1226 Shore Road. The circulation proposal has several aspects. One is, in terms of Town Hall, is to maintain circulation just as it is now, with one-way circulation entering the south side of Town Hall and exiting on the north side. What we're doing, however, is reorienting all the parking behind Town Hall. I guess in the retail tradition, we're making those parking bays perpendicular to the destination rather than parallel, so that the pedestrian movements are consistent and flow well with the vehicular movements. And starting about this location, where the existing parking is, stretching parking further to the east. I'll get into the parking numbers in a moment. We're maintaining all the existing paving behind Town Hall, with the exception where we're removing some to create some islands for shade trees in this location. This area now is all turf, and that will just not be a paved area that will become landscape. We are connecting the rear of the Town Hall lot through a 20-foot driveway that will have two-way traffic that extends along this west property line and exits and enters from 1226 Shore Road. So people will continue to use the Town Hall lot as it's used today. For those who live north and east of town, perhaps after meetings, they may exit from this driveway, or people who are intending to use 1226 Shore Road will enter from Shore Road in either direction and come in and park behind the existing house. Pedestrian circulation will be through the parking bays behind Town Hall, toward Town Hall, up to the side and front entrances as it exists now. In addition, as you see on the plan, there's a 5-foot sidewalk that extends from the rear of Town Hall along the proposed driveway with an entrance either to the side of the building or around the existing garage into the front door. We are proposing, as I said before, expanding the parking behind Town Hall. We're looking for an increase, if I just check out the numbers. We have now in Town Hall a total of 16 spaces in the front that include 2 handicapped spaces here, 3 spaces just to the south of the building, and then several more on the south side of the entrance. And in the rear, we have an additional 23 for a total parking spaces of 39. We're proposing to eliminate 3 spaces here, create a drop-off area for 2 vehicles near the side entrance to Town Hall, and maintain the angle parking on the south property lines as it is now. In addition to that, we're proposing 55 spaces total behind Town Hall for a net increase. I don't have it in front of me, but it's on one of the charts. I believe it's about 37 spaces behind Town Hall. We also have behind 1226 Shore Road in this parking area 20 cars and 2 handicap spaces located conveniently right off 1226 off the Shore Road. It's proposed that this will be accessed either through the front door of the existing building or through a revised entrance scheme that Terry and Architects is currently working on that will create an entrance through the garage. All the spaces behind Town Hall are delineated to be 10 feet by 20 feet. The existing spaces, although that's somewhat larger than typical parking spaces today, that is the existing stripe pattern behind Town Hall. We felt for many of the elderly people who use Town Hall, as well as the varied size vehicles, that's a good size to stay with. However, behind 1226 Shore Road would make them slightly smaller, but consistent with zoning and consistent with many other communities. Because of the closeness to the abutting properties and the significant number of trees that are located behind that building. In terms of landscaping, we really have it's minimum improvements. Other than the shade trees behind Town Hall, there are a significant number of trees that already exist here, and we're trying very carefully not to cut down any more than necessary. In fact, have aligned the road to avoid one of the major pine trees. But things that are obvious is a need to screen the east side of this parking lot to create some sort of visual buffer screen between the adjacent construction storage yard and the town-owned driveway, and then creating a sense of entry and buffering adjacent to the handicapped parking. The goal of, I believe, of the committee and of Mike's to maintain this structure in a very similar residential scale rather than to provide creating sort of a municipal type scale, and the landscaping will help do that. In terms of proposed lighting, we're looking at one additional pole fixture either in the east end of this lot or somewhere near the intersection here. There are existing building mounted lights on this shed as well as the rear town hall and pole mounted light in front of 1226 Shore Road. Drainage, we're really proposing minimal improvements. We're following the existing contours. There used to be tennis courts behind Town Hall and a baseball field, and those grades follow quite suitably for parking lots. And we'll continue to drain the water from the northwest to southeast, as well as to drain it along the proposed driveway, and eventually finding a low area here where we'll have a culvert, as well as to follow the existing swales on either side of this parking lot and continue to drain to the east and to the south. And I don't know, Mike, if you've handed out the budget estimate, but we have prepared a fairly detailed budget estimate, so we know where we stand from that standpoint at this point. I'd be happy to answer any questions that you may have. Yes.
I believe in our plan, it doesn't show that total of 55 parking spaces out back. Could you indicate where the additional ones are going to be?
They need to see the two right next to the garage. She hasn't.
Oh, right in here.
Are there only two, mm-hmm. or?
There are two on the west side of the garage and two here near the
okay.
corner.
Okay.
Those are shown on the plan we received tonight.
Yeah, there are two copies of the plan. One showed just the seven spaces in back of 1226, and the other shows the full 20. The seven just would not have met the needs. The seven is the 20 is seven and seven plus three more. And then there's also, and the earlier plan did not show the sidewalk.
That's correct.
Nor did it show the two spaces that are currently used right here next to the garage out back on this side of the garage.
Yes.
Councilor Amaro.
Is there a drop-off area in front of the Jones property, the house?
There's not one. You mean directly at Shore Road or when?
No. If you were bringing, say, we envision that there'll be a lot of senior citizen use of the facility, and there are only two parking spots in the front for handicap. Is there a place where people could be dropped off?
The only place where people could be dropped off is within the travel way. And they're really, between the property line and the building, there's less than 26 feet, and with a 20-foot driveway, that doesn't leave much room to provide any additional width of drop-off. If you look closely at the building, you see there's an entrance, there's a granite pad there that's about 4 feet wide. There's plantings on each side of the building, so we really haven't been able to find the room to do that. A thought that occurred to us, and one that we didn't explore, is perhaps a loop drop-off in front of the house. And that was primarily because of the addition of another curb cut, where we already have adjacent driveway here. There's one just a little further down the road, and then the Rand parcel there. I haven't discussed this with Mike, but that was really the only other alternative that I could see for a drop-off. Other than to reserve one parking space here, we could squeeze one more space so that people could pull in, drop somebody off, and then back out and go on their way.
How far away is the parking for the house from the building?
Right here?
Yeah, how far
it's
away?
It's about 120 feet.
It's immediately in back of the fence that's there. We didn't want to, we wanted to maintain the nice backyard for events. We're already infringing upon that area with the driveway going out on the side. We didn't want to infringe on the back of it as well.
Other questions? Councilor Jordan.
Yes, you just made a comment that kind of lit up the light with me about somebody dropping off and backing out, which I would say that should be a no-no, backing out into Shore Road, especially at that point.
No, they wouldn't back out.
And they wouldn't be backing directly into Shore Road. They would be backing out into the proposed driveway.
Well, if you have handicapped parking there, is there going to be room enough for them to back around?
If we had one more space that we called reserved, just like a T-intersection at the end of a dead-end street, for example, if we reserved one additional space for that function, then they could back out directly into the driveway, not into Shore Road.
And you only have two handicaps available?
That's correct.
That's all you could get there? That didn't seem to be too many.
Law requires one per 25 spaces, so we're right at the requirement with the four that we provide for both buildings.
But the use of the building seems so it would need more than two, in my opinion.
Other comments? Councilor McLaughlin?
Couldn't listen. Tom knew I'd have questions. You did provide us with a good cost estimate sheet here. What would be the cost for relocating the foam pole? Is that included
of,
in here?
Of relocating the flagpole?
Phone pole.
Phone pole.
Where you're proposing the driveway to go
as,
in.
As far as I know, CMP is obligated to do that if their pole falls within your way. In other words, it's on our property, then they have to move it at our convenience. There may be some cost to us with respect to connecting back to the house, but I don't know what those numbers are.
The town council grants pole location permits, and CMP is not in a position to charge the town for. Similarly, you don't charge them for pole location permits.
Okay. No, I've just run into instances where that has been a significant cost to an applicant before. I did speak yesterday with the immediate butters to the east, the Rands, and while I did not have the revised L1 drawing, I did show them a very rough sketch of the parking lot between the 1220 Shore Road property expanded to 20 spaces rather than the 7 being shown previously, and talked with them about the buffering that could be provided that they would like to see for that parking lot. Their main concern was for car headlights bothering them, and the preference I heard was for a fence rather than a vegetated buffer. I think we're still seeing vegetated buffer. That's certainly fine to include, but I would go along and say that a fence would be something to put up there. We talked about the possibility of having it just extend, continuing the existing fence line out, something like that.
I don't see any problem with that at all.
If you could do that. I'm wondering also about screening users of the 1226 property from the equipment storage and such on the west to the west side, and wondering if a fence or the fence I see where the road location interferes with part of the existing fence location, if that fence could be extended to where you're proposing the arborvitae planting.
What we've done is taking sections of the fence and put it on the east side of the driveway. As Mike described it, it would be very nice to be using this building and have a sense of privacy without having to deal with the driveway at the same time, particularly for group functions. I don't know if you're aware of it. There is a lilac, a hedge that's not lilac, but it's a honeysuckle that runs down to about this location, just beyond the existing fence line. The only drawback I could see would be perhaps maintenance and those sorts of things. Arborvitae will take pretty severe neglect and abuse that might happen between those two properties. But the only other drawback I would see is cost. But it's something we can certainly explore and let you know what the implications are.
Okay, I'm not real comfortable with driving between, you know, having the pavement between two fences, which is what this scenario could play out to be. But I've had a lot of comments from people about having to, keep driving by that equipment storage area. Mm-hmm. They don't like what they see there necessarily. You know, it's a permitted use and all that. Would also help to screen the radio tower, the view of the radio tower on that adjacent property. A fence might, if that thing comes over towards the 1226 property, I don't know which would better break its fall onto the 1226 property. That's another concern. There is, just so everybody's aware, that there is allocation in your cost estimate for a sign.
That's correct.
This will meet the current sign ordinance. It is in a residential district, so my assumption is it will meet the residential sign size, which is not large and not a gommy type sign.
I told Mrs. Ram when I met with her today it's going to be just like the one at the public safety building.
After I assure her it wouldn't be.
No, I reassured her that it probably be wood in nature and definitely in keeping with the sign ordinance.
Yes, we had a very nice discussion about the sign. Other discussions we had. Other concerns have been brought to my attention, I just want to bring up, is about the possible, and I assume probable, existence of underground storage tanks within the easement.
That's correct.
Which, and I did speak with the manager about that today, and I understand that we can get evidence of the DEP registration of those tanks and know a bit more than, you know, at least I do right now, about the condition of those tanks, if they've been replaced recently. I'm concerned a bit about the lighting situation. Is there still going to be that residential scale pole light at the front of the 1226?
Yes.
Okay, in this drawing. I wasn't sure about that. Could you show me again where a pole light is proposed at the rear?
Probably in this area here to illuminate this intersection and to provide light for this corner as well as to provide light in this area.
Okay, I would recommend we look at least one more, maybe a residential scale light to assist in illumination for people parking in the lot behind the 1226 building and walking from that lot to that building. I think we need a light out back there.
I think that's a good idea.
Yes. You know, I have to envision my mother parking or somebody's aunt parking there. Okay. Now, it seems to my recollection is we were talking about one-way traffic onto or off of Shore Road for this property. I now sense that we're talking about two-way traffic. I would still prefer one-way traffic. How would you like to address that?
Well, there's been a lot of discussion, and no one could seem to come to a consensus as to which way that one-way traffic would best serve the needs. And the way it was left is it felt one real function that this driveway could serve as a release valve after large meetings. But that would mean anyone who wanted to use 1226 Shore Road would have to come to Town Hall, would have to maneuver through the lot and then come to this location. And the practicality of that happening is about nil. What people would do is they knew where they want to go, so they'd go there. And seeing that it was a one-way drive and seeing that no one was in the drive, they would drive the wrong way down a one-way driveway. So I think the compromise is to keep it fairly narrow at 20 feet, which also encourages slow speeds, and the impact is about the same as a one-way driveway.
The other issue, Counselor, in that we looked at was people, particularly who aren't used to the facility, want to go to it as a focal point. And so when they arrive at the scene, you know, over on Shore Road, they're going to want to come in that driveway. It doesn't make any sense, people that really don't know where it is, to send them to the town hall. So that gave the persuasive influence that if it was one way, you'd want to do it coming in. Then we get into the situation, well, what about people who, again, the elderly question, if you need to go pick people up at the door, in order to go pick them up, unless you had a two-way, you'd have to send them all the way through the town hall lot, all the way back out onto 77 and do the whole loop through the intersection, and that seemed a little bit excessive. So that's why it eventually came out two-way, that it just seemed a lot better ease of operation and a lot better understanding for those that would be using the facility as well as the town hall.
We also have Shore Road, the problem Shore Road traffic in 77 too, and this would prevent adding extra traffic to that intersection.
So maybe we won't need a stoplight.
Yeah, I didn't want to be accused of making a proposal that was going to create more evidence for a traffic light.
And you know,
like I was a few meetings ago.
You know how much I appreciate
that. Do you have any
other comments? Yeah, I'm not done yet. I got to redline Tom's drawing for a change.
Well, this is going to be sent to the planning board for complete review too.
I would rather have the changes made before it goes to planning board than have us held up for another month of the planning board time. You're talking about the parking stalls behind Town Hall at 20 by 10. I'm not convinced. I know that's the existing situation out there. We're going to be restriping it anyway. So the striping situation becomes the moot point. I'm not convinced that they have to be 10 by 20. I think that's excessive paving out there. Can you argue it your way?
I think the lot is as big as it is. And the difference would be whether we have the number of spaces that are indicated on the plan or we have a few more. I guess in my experience in parking out back is I don't find a lot of extra room in those spaces. I'm one who always argues for smaller spaces. But I don't know what it is, whether people are in a hurry and they tend to park toward one side or the other, and eventually you get into automobile creep. We're amenable to 9 by 18 or 10 by 20, but I think the configuration of the lot, because it ties into
driveway to Shore Road is the eastern extent of it will be about where it is now. And the main difference will be increased number of parking spaces.
I'm not particularly looking for more parking spaces at this time. I would be looking for less pavement. I understand the situation with lining up with that access road, but I think we would have to have less pavement to the south.
Along here?
Yes. If it were narrower.
What happened? It would narrow up in this direction. It would pull up in this direction. But if you come by and drive past this garage now, you'll notice that there's a great big hump in front of the garage doors. Okay. And it just happens that this wider bay pulls that first row of parking here about where it ought to be so that the maneuvering lane avoids that hump. If we narrow that up, that's going to pull everything up toward the garage. We can keep one side wide and the other one narrow.
Good argument for it. Thank you.
The other constraint with that, Counselor, is we want to be able to leave open the area in front of the garage doors so that the fire equipment and public works equipment can get in and out of there. Mm-hmm.
Okay. You do have a note in your letter, Tom, from a suggestion from the surveyor that rights within the right-of-way along the west property line be determined by council. That is something I would encourage us to do as soon as possible. I think that's that's an issue of concern that I hope we will deal with expeditiously. Thank you.
Councilor Jordan.
Back to the fence deal just for a minute. You're going to take the fence and move it over on the other side of the road so that people in there would have some...
The existing fence actually is that we won't move runs from about just about the length of the house. And then as it kind of cuts back in toward the driveway, we're going to move that section to the east side of the driveway where it meets the corner now or the rear fence line.
I personally feel you ought to have a fence the whole length of it on the west side instead of trying to block the shield the activities within the building and the backyard there, which is what you're planning to do. It kind of boxes it in, I would think, in the long run, and in the future we'd rather have the fence on the other side of the road full length. I think it would make it much better.
You want it so we have the privacy in the yard or that the driveway comes up at this, so you can see the driveway from the yard? I'm trying to follow you.
I want it so you if you have the fence on the west side, you've got your privacy in the yard and the driveway and everything. You've got your own privacy all the way through. And I think if you think of the future, you would rather see it that way than move the fence over and kind of box in one area there around the house and the back door you have there. And as far as the light that was just on, if you put a proper light there and it's high enough, wouldn't that take care of both parking areas? Isn't that on? Do you need two? I just kind of hesitate to see them two lights.
Well, but it's a thing that's unique about this property is that it's a little mini forest. I mean, it's very heavily treed, and I think it would be extremely difficult to get light without illuminating the construction yard at the same time to illuminate in this direction and that direction. And sooner or later, you can get into that silhouette effect issue where people can't see where they're walking because the light's shining in their eyes. I think Janet's suggestion of a lower level light, pedestrian level light back in that parking area is probably a wise approach.
Well, I would agree with that if the other one wouldn't take care of it. So they definitely need a light if they come out in the evening and come down to the
I just wanted to point out to the public that the town manager has sent copies of the preliminary site plan to both of the abutters and has spoken with each of the abutters and has their comments too. So we're trying to be good neighbors. You wanted to say something?
Yeah, just on that point to follow up on Councillor McLaughlin's comments. I did meet with Mrs. Rand today after she had a chance to look at the plan. Her preference would be to have both a fence and shrubbery around that side of the parking lot, and we'll try to accommodate that request. Secondly, as you look at the cost estimate, That does contemplate using just about totally outside resources, and a lot of this work would be done by town forces without being charged off to the account. So we would hope that the final cost would be somewhat less than the amount you see before you.
I have a question on the drainage. Currently, the drainage from the town hall site drains over to the abutters' property, and we're creating our own little mini wetlands there. Are we now adding all the continued drainage from 1226 that will become washing down into this area? Is it ultimately because of the natural drainage going to add to that?
That's a good question. We have DeLuca Hoffman as our consulting civil engineer, this part of the team. They will be preparing a detailed drainage report. They have reviewed the plan and think that the original concept of grading is fine. They don't really feel that there's a need for detention because there just isn't a large enough area of water, particularly at 1226 Shore Road. These areas are existing. It just happens that the parking lot's on a ridge, and it does currently drain into these two swale areas. So we're really following the existing drainage course. I don't know that there's going to be enough significant runoff that would harm any abutting properties, but that's certainly something that DeLuca Hoffman will be looking at in greater detail as we prepare our applications.
Other comments from councilors? Mr. McGovern.
I'm sorry. I have one correction to make, and in case someone is watching that might be offended. I have not spoken to the owner of the abutting property on this side. I have spoken to her son.
Her son. That's right.
Slight difference.
Well, I think it's exciting to start to see this all evolve. And we have had a serious problem with the parking in the town hall for years, and this seems a much more sophisticated approach. If there are no other questions or comments of Mr. Emery, then I'd like a motion on this item.
Madam Chairman, I move that we authorize the manager to proceed with the site plan application to the planning board.
Any more discussion?
And zoning board, and anybody else in need?
If not, all in favor? It's a 6-0.
Thank you very much.
Very nice, Mr. Emery.
Thank you.
Can you leave that board here?
Certainly.
Thank you.
I don't want you running out through there when you get done your meeting.
It's also a plan of the building here.
I just heard one.
Proposed.
Okay. We have a couple more items to go. Item number 185. To consider the status of town council goals for 1990-1991 and take any necessary action. Mr. McGovern.
I just jotted a few notes, essentially where you stand on all your different goals. The goal year runs from when the new council takes office to when the old council leaves. And I don't mean old in terms of age. This runs until the second Monday in June for the goals. If there are any goals that you have questions on, this would be a good time to do it. If there's any that you would like to see quick action on between now and the second Monday in June, let me know and we'll get working on it. But I don't think I'm the one to qualitatively comment on how you're doing, but I think the comments speak for themselves. If anyone else wishes to qualitatively comment.
I think we've done a rather good job. For the first time ever, we've really prioritized our goals and objectives. But I do feel there is one area in which we're a little weak, which still seems to be in that twilight zone. And I feel that perhaps more of the input should be from our administrator, because he relates to the employees more, which is implementing an employee recognition program. I think that was one item that we didn't advance as quickly or as much on.
What was that one?
Implement an employee recognition program.
Oh.
So we have something that is provided for the fire department volunteers, but I'd like to see something a little more extensive.
If you've been at spouses now, you think there's plenty of them recognized.
But we have other employees other than just fire department volunteers, too.
I think maybe we can get into something of employee appreciation. We seem to have a hard time with recognition. Maybe we'll revise it to employee appreciation.
Any comments from other counselors?
I got one for next year already.
We'll be starting on that very soon. Thank you, Mr. McGovern. Item number 186, to consider a request from New England Telephone for conduit location on Fowler Road and Old Ocean House Road and take any necessary action. Mr. McGovern?
Yes, the telephone company would like to improve upon and upgrade their underground conduit through the intersection of Fowler Road, Old Ocean House Road, and Ocean House Road. They have applied to the Maine Department of Transportation, the regulatory authority for Route 77, to place the conduit under Route 77. I would like to point out this is not in the area of new pavement. It is just north of it. They are approaching the council for approximately 30 feet on, approximately 149 feet on Fowler Road and approximately 158 feet on Old Ocean House Road of conduit and shown on the plans here. As usual, they have not notified us as to why they are requesting this to be done.
Councilor McLaughlin.
How much of this is going to involve disruption of the pavement?
The cross piece, very definitely.
At the end of Fowler there?
As it cuts across the major part of the intersection for some 87 feet, the road.
Maybe you don't have it.
It's on the other one that's only for the records.
Okay.
That's where it cuts across.
Just a minute.
Beyond that, it would be
7 feet.
at the edge of the pavement.
And this will be taking place on July 4th weekend.
You could, if desired, set certain standards for that. We haven't heard yet from MDOT if they're approving it. I would assume that they probably will, but I don't know.
Councilor Amaral.
Why don't we ever get an explanation as to why this is needed?
Because the phone company is a very traditional organization, and they have not updated it. If the council we have from time to time on different projects. If the council has a policy, would like to ask that they submit that with their request, that we could advise the phone company of that.
So moved.
Yeah. I think that any submission by any group should always have an explanation with it, whether it be private, public, or monopolistic.
Most of these are fairly simple, but this, in fact, is underground conduit and involved digging up the road.
Councilor Amaral.
Would there be any problem with tabling this to the June meeting?
And would you like me to ask a representative of the phone company to come? Philly. Yeah, this is a substantial intersection.
Yes,
it is. Councilor McLaughlin.
I think that's a wonderful idea. I'm still confused. Okay, I heard 87 feet of opening across the intersection. Yeah. It still looks to me like they're crossing the end of Fowler Road, too. Not on that drawing, but on another drawing. In the 186 item.
They obviously have to, yes. 30 feet.
Unless they've revised.
So we're going to have
30 feet across and then 119
Fowler.
Down.
119. So it's 30 feet across the end of Fowler, then 87 feet across the intersection itself.
Yeah. And 14 feet from the center line on Fowler Road.
But this also looks like they're going down 112 feet along 77.
I think on Fowler Road, that puts them outside the pavement width. The pavement's 22 feet.
Yep.
That along the side, you're outside of the pavement width, which is what I kept trying to figure out when I was looking this over. When they do come before us, I would like to know their timetable for doing these, as well as their reason.
What I will do is try to get for them actual plans of the road so that they can better display where it is in relation to pavement, so they can tell us when they plan to do it, why they plan to do it, what activities, you know, obviously they'd have to follow the street opening permit requirements.
Did they give you any indication of when they plan to do this? This is what we have is what we have.
Right. Oh, how long it will take. Councilor Amaral.
I move that item 186 be tabled to the June meeting of the town council.
Second motion, one comment, if I may.
It's time for discussion.
Not on the table.
Not on the table.
Not on tabling, no.
So I can't make my comment?
No.
You can make it after.
Oh, thank you.
Okay, let's see. Mr. McGovern, no,
vote.
Citizens discussion.
Oh, can we
vote?
Oh, we're going to vote to table. Sorry. That was a given. All those in favor? It's a 6-0.
Sorry.
And there's no controversy. It's citizens discussion of items not on the agenda.
My comment.
There being none from up front, is there a comment from other citizens sitting at the dais?
No, I just want to say, as far as the power company goes, I think the reason they would like to do this and not being a member or an official or the president of the own company, evidently they want to improve services going down to the Cape. And also there are some new houses down this, alongside the strip, and I think they have to improve the services there because they've already dug up down there by one pole already and done some work there. So we'll wait for their recommendations.
Okay. There being no other discussions or citizen comments, Mr. McGovern, I believe you had some comments with council.
Yeah, I just had one quick item, both but relating to two separate issues. I've been asked to testify in Augusta on Wednesday on two different bills. I try to stay away from Augusta, but these two bills are one that are of particular concern to Cape Elizabeth. And before I went and testified, participated in a hearing, I wanted to just be doubly assured that the council is supportive of what I'm saying. The first bill relates to the Greater Portland Council of Governments, and it merely makes clear in state statutory enabling legislation that the towns can obligate by council vote guarantees of loans taken by the Greater Portland Council of Governments from financial institutions. Is there any objection to that one? This is in the council already voted to guarantee it, but then the lawyers got involved and said maybe you didn't have the statutory authority to do so. This would create the statutory authority. The second bill is involves the recycling containers, similar to what you see at the transfer station. And Regional Waste Systems has been trying to get those placed on private land as well as public land. The hang-up they get is the liability that is involved from putting it on private land. This particular bill that's proposed would exempt private landowners from any responsibility for recycling facilities on their land, provided that there's no malicious or willful intent to create a hazard or a liability. But what it would tend to do is to give comfort to private landowners to allow, with their permission, to place these recycling bins on their property.
Are there such private landowners anticipated in this town?
Yes. None have been approached as of yet. There's been discussion at the staff level about approaching one. At this point, we're not doing anything until the first meeting of the recycling committee, which is later this month, and we're going to be talking the issue with them.
Sounds like a good idea to me, but who's going to protect the individual? He would have to have an attorney if he was sued, even though you have this statute, because the attorneys get involved one way or the other. They get arguing back and forth. And so that individual that had that there would have to protect himself. Who would pay his bill?
Yeah, that could be worked out by whatever body was putting the recycling unit on the property. But, you know, clearly there should be quite a bit of comfort in the fact that the bill would provide, and then, you know, any lawyer representing a client ought to be able to read the statute and see that, you know, unless it was willful or malicious, that...
I think most any lawyer can find a way to interpret most any law or not in scope, so the client would have to be protected.
Yeah. One, if there's no objection, I will testify on both bills. I think this brings up another issue in that, you know, department heads and others are often asked to go up and testify on bills. Whenever staff goes, we always, you know, I would assume the person stands up and says, I'm the police chief of Cape Elizabeth, I'm the public works director. Does the council wish to authorize those visits? Sometimes it's tough with legislation coming so fast in hearings. But do you feel comfortable with department head speaking, giving their position and title, and testifying in Augusta?
I think as long as you know the gist of what they're going to be saying, that's fine.
That's within your authority to say yes or no, depending on the issue.
I have no problem with it, because I've been down there twice with Chief Pickering on four-legged deer, and he represented people very respectfully. I think they should go, because those people down there look for the ones that are involved with the community and the department heads and what have you. So whether you want to clear it, it's okay with me, but I don't think the council should get involved with it.
They do. All of the department heads who do make such visits always call me in advance. Tell me. Thank you.
You're welcome. I want to remind the council of our workshop this Wednesday evening and our councilor-elect. I hope you will join us.
Monday.
Excuse me. Wednesday is the Portland Headlight fundraiser committee.
And I hope you all will attend.
The meeting next week, the agenda on Monday includes a report from Maureen O'Meara, the town planner, on the town center process and exactly soliciting your views on how that should go. An update on the comprehensive plan in its entirety, and perhaps some discussion with Maureen as to what you feel her priorities ought to be in working with the plan, should you have any, you know, beyond what you've already said. Obviously, you have priorities, but I'll be done in a minute. Third, you will be having a little bit more discussion of goals. I'm forgetting something.
Selection of committees.
And yeah, following the workshop, there'll be a caucus of the new council to review the council organization for the next council year.
Sounds like a busy evening.
There's one other item that's on the workshop portion as well that is not a lengthy one. It escapes my mind at this point.
Comments from anyone else? I'll take a motion for adjournment.
So moved.
Second. In favor? 6-0. Good night, everyone.
Seriously, if you know anyone interested in buying those bonds, encourage them.
Janice?